Good morning, church. This is my first Sunday here this year, so I wish you a little bit late Happy New Year and pray God's blessings on this church and on your life, 2017. It's a special day in the life of the church, whether you know it or not. Last Sunday, we celebrated New Year's Day by, I guess, what you'd call the secular Julian calendar. But the church's calendar started some weeks ago. It was the first Sunday of Advent that the new Christian year begins. And we celebrated through Advent, and then Christmas came, and we gathered and worshiped and celebrated the coming of our Lord. And that followed a season of the 12 days of Christmas, like the song. The 12th day of Christmas was Friday, that passed January 6th, which is a day in the Christian calendar, a holy day called Epiphany. And it celebrates the time when the wise men, the magi, came from the east and the star appeared to them over the house where Jesus was. And these Gentiles came to Christ Jesus. The shepherds, the Jews, had all been gathered around the manger, but the Gentiles came later. And you and I, most of us, I assume, being Gentiles, that would be a pretty special day for us, celebrating the time when the first Gentiles acknowledge Jesus as King. And so on this Sunday, in many churches around the country and around the world, actually, that's celebrated as the coming of the gospel to the Gentiles. And it's something worth celebrating this 12th day of Christmas, God's great gift of including people like us, not just Israel, but the Gentiles as well. The text this morning that we're going to be looking at in Acts chapter 10 celebrates that reality, the coming of the gospel to the Gentiles for the first time. Peter was asleep when his world changed. Peter was often asleep in the gospel accounts. I don't know if you've noticed that. He slept in the Garden of Gethsemane. He was asleep up on the Mountain of Transfiguration. He was asleep on a rooftop here in Joppa. He was staying at the home of Simon the Tanner at his seaside home in Joppa. He had been doing ministry there on the coast, and he was taking a few days of R&R. He went up on the flat rooftop there to pray at the hour of prayer at noon, and he was hungry. Lunch was being prepared downstairs. Maybe he could smell it coming up, and you could look from that flat rooftop out across the bay there in the Mediterranean and maybe see sailing vessels with their sheets, their sails billowing in the wind. He was at the home of Simon the Tanner. Perhaps there were some hides hanging on ropes down in the courtyard there waiting to be dealt with by the tanner, and they would have been considered unclean items for a Jewish person. There were a lot of things going on in Peter's mind and environment at that moment, and he was getting drowsy, just a little drowsy, and he fell off to sleep. And the next thing you know, God is giving him a dream, a vision. In his dream, all those things are sort of working together. He's hungry, and this sheet is let down out of heaven like a big sail, and it comes down out of heaven, and inside of it, to Peter's dismay, everything that would have been considered unclean by Jewish standards of diet were in there. There were shrimp and catfish and eels and other things that he wouldn't have thought of eating. There were pigs running around. I don't know. It was a sheet full of unclean animals. And the voice of the Lord comes to Peter and says, "Arise, Peter, kill and eat." And Peter protests, "Not so, Lord. You know my record. You've seen my diet. I have never eaten anything unclean by the law." And the Lord speaks to Peter and says, "What I have declared to be clean, you have no business declaring to be unclean." And just for good measure, that dream repeated two more times. Now, meanwhile, while Peter's up there taking his noonday nap, praying, there's a knock at the door of Simon the Tanner's house. Some folks from up the coast at Caesarea have been dispatched by an important soldier there, a man named Cornelius, a Roman centurion, who was a devout man. He worshiped the God of Israel, not the Roman gods. And in his worship and in his generosity, God saw his heart that he was attracted to the truth of God. And so a vision had come to him a couple of days earlier. An angel appeared and said to him, Cornelius, God has heard your prayers. He's seen your generosity. He knows your heart. And I want you to send someone down the coast about 40 miles to Joppa. There's a man named Simon Peter that you need to meet. He's staying in the home of Simon the Tanner. Send for him. And Cornelius, a couple of days earlier, had dispatched these emissaries. And just as Peter finished his dream, there's a knock at the door, and these folks arrived. And the Spirit said to Peter as he was coming out of his stupor and his vision, there's some people at the gate asking for you. Go with them and don't ask any questions. And so Peter climbed downstairs, and sure enough, there are these folks from up the coast, and they were Gentiles. One of them was a soldier, the oppressors of Israel. And they said, our master has asked for you to come. He had a dream. So Peter said, you all stay with me tonight. You've traveled a long way. And the next day they got up and made their way back towards Caesarea and arrived on the second day. It was a world-changing event. Peter arrived and he was still unsure of himself and unsure of what God was up to and asking of him. And when he arrived at this Gentile's home, he began with an apology. In verse 27 of Acts 10, Peter went inside, found a large gathering of people, and he said to them, you are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But God has shown me I should not call any man impure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objection. May I ask why you sent for me? That's kind of an apology. This is not standard operating procedures for us Jews, Peter said, to be in a Gentile's home like this. But God has said to me, I'm not supposed to be calling people unclean, apparently. And so here I am. What can I do for you? Cornelius then told his story, and Peter then began to preach the gospel to them. The world had changed for Peter. Apparently, God was working in the life and heart of this Gentile, this Roman soldier, this enemy oppressor of Israel. And so Peter preached the gospel. He was resolved to bear witness to the gospel wherever God sent him to bear witness. And he preached to the Gentiles for the very first time. His sermon is summarized in beginning there in verse 34. Peter began to speak, and now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and who does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went about doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross. But God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God has appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin through his name. It's an important text. The first time this good news was made available to people like us, Gentiles, people without all of Israel's heritage and history. And God is announcing through his spokesman, Peter, his witness, Peter calls himself. He's announcing through his witness that Jesus Christ has come for us too. It is an important moment. But it was a world-changing moment for Peter as he awoke from his sleep to find out that God was up to this new thing. Maybe like Simon Peter or Rip Van Winkle, you may have been asleep when the revolution took place and woke up rather suddenly, perhaps a few years ago, to the fact that the world has changed. It's not the same as it once was within many of your memories. Or more likely than sleeping through the revolution, you and I are like the proverbial frog in the kettle, who makes himself comfortable and the temperature is gradually raised, and he never notices how the changes come so slowly and inexorably until suddenly the water is boiling and it's too late. The 21st century world that we are now 16% done with is in so many ways radically different, revolutionarily different from the world that people my age grew up in. The world has changed in so many ways. Everything has changed. It's not just technology and scientific knowledge that has changed in the last 50 or 60 years, but everything has changed. Morality has changed. Views of truth have changed. Human relationships have changed. Marriage and family have changed. The world has been radically changed in the last 50 or 60 years in ways we could not imagine. In fact, a list of the changes would be so comprehensive, there'd be hardly anything in our world that would be left out of it. And yet, it's come gradually, by degree, and suddenly the water's boiling, and we never really saw it coming. And the church has struggled to come to terms with a world that has changed so very much. Those of us, say, that are over 55, say, can remember a time which, at least on the surface, the church in a community played a pretty significant role and had a pretty significant degree of influence. And that world no longer exists except in our memories. It really doesn't. The church in the 21st century at this point is far more marginalized than we were 50 or 60 years ago. There was a time, I didn't experience this, but came a little late for that, but there was a time when the ministers, the clergy in a community were among the most respected people in the community. Gallup does a poll every year. I haven't seen the one for 2016, but they usually do it in December, where it's called the Honesty and Ethics Poll, and they ask the population about various professions and the degree to which they trust them as highly ethical people. In 2015, clergy were thought by only 45% of the population to be ethically and morally trustworthy. 55% didn't think so. We're down there right now with congressmen. The world has changed radically. John Dickerson has a book called The Great Evangelical Recession. And he himself is an evangelical Christian. He believes in Scripture. He believes in Jesus Christ. He claims to be born again. And he is writing a warning to the evangelical church that there is a need for a wake-up call, that the world has changed. One of the things he notes in there, which is really interesting, is that for a long time, evangelical Christians have been saying that we represent somewhere between, who was doing the counting, 40 to 70% of the population. In other words, that 7 out of 10 people you run into at Walmart are born-again Christians. John Dickerson says there are more realistic studies that have been done from several areas, not just one, that say the range is probably more likely 7 to 9% of the population are evangelical Christians. Not 150 million, but 22 million, about the population of the state of New York. If you could imagine all evangelicals gathered into the state of New York and all 49 other states being made up of those who do not profess Jesus Christ. We have a group in our population, of which most of us are a part then, that we assume that we represent a pretty good majority viewpoint. We assume that because once we did. And then we watch around us as the things that we value are ignored or destroyed or eroded or bypassed or contradicted, and it makes us angry. Why is the world behaving this way? And the answer is because it's the world. It's not the church. Our voice has been diminished in volume over time, and we didn't see it coming. This is the world in which we are called to carry out our mission for Jesus Christ, a world in which we've been increasingly marginalized, we are less trusted, and there are fewer of us in the market. That's where we've been called to work. We are a minority voice today, and yesterday doesn't matter that much. The religious and moral and ethical landscape has been cataclysmically revised. And that's what we face. Now, I don't see that as entirely bad news. The observation has some pretty profound implications for how we behave as Christians and how we act as church in a world like this. We can no longer assume that the world knows what we're talking about when we use words like the gospel of Jesus Christ. When we speak of Jesus Christ at all, his name is known primarily as a curse word that is used in popular media and everyday conversation. But his story is widely unknown by people in our world when once it was. Words like gospel and sin and salvation and redemption don't speak to everybody the way they did not very long ago. Missiologist George Hunter says that our world is made not of atheists and agnostics, but of what he calls ignostics. They just don't know. We can't assume they do anymore. We can no longer assume that our influence is strong enough in the world that they're interested in what we have to say as Christians, as the church. We can no longer assume that simply quoting the Bible to people will be taken as a source of authority any more than any other book would be taken by a source of authority in this world. We can no longer assume that people have an inkling of what it means to respond to the God who created them, who loves them, and who has sent his Son to die for them. We can't assume that. In fact, the spiritual and religious landscape at the beginning of the 21st century is far more similar to the landscape faced by that first century church than it is to the one faced by the church 60 or 70 years ago. We are closer to the first century in the 21st century in many ways than we are to the 20th century. We have an apostolic church whose story is found in the book of Acts. It gives us some encouragement about what it means to bear witness in a world like this. And we need to pay attention to them, our brothers and sisters who walk before us 2,100 years ago. In a secular world like ours and like theirs, at least in the non-Christian world, the church has four primary tasks. We have to inform the world about who Jesus is. They don't already know anymore. We need to influence the world by our lives and our ministries. The person and the bodies like this church who bear witness and attempt to bear witness in the world have to influence it by our lives and our ministries. Our words are not enough in a world like this. Our apologetics and arguments have to be backed up with lives and ministry that reflect Jesus Christ. We have to persuade the world with our words and thoughts and influence them with our life and deeds. And we have to invite them to receive the gift that is offered to us by God in Jesus Christ. They don't already know how to respond. So we carry out that task of witness and ministry, and we do so taking our lead from our brothers and sisters who walk before us and whose story is found in the book of Acts. We learn some other things from them about this kind of work in this kind of world. We learn that our power must come from God the Holy Spirit. It's not going to be done by our own strength, our own intelligence, our own gifts, our own abilities, our own resources. We learn that our connection with God's power and leadership come through the experience of common prayer. Prayer is a big theme in the book of Acts, but nearly always it is communal prayer. There's only one episode I can find of an individual praying in the book of Acts, but lots of examples of the church praying together about its task, about its mission, about its world. We learn from them that our means of getting a hearing in a world like this is our authentic experience with God, our authentic love for one another, and our compassionate ministry to human hurts and hopes, our willingness to be available to God. That's where we get the hearing. We're called to that. So the book of Acts becomes this vital document for our thinking about the task of bearing witness. How did the first century church do its work in a world that didn't already know the story, that didn't already find itself persuaded, already accept the authority of what these people said? How did the first century church do that? What does it mean to be a church in such a setting? What does it mean to bear witness? What does it mean to be empowered to bear witness? What's required? We have the same Holy Spirit to empower us as they did. We sang of his presence with us this morning several times. We have the same gospel, good news of King Jesus who has come to be born that they had. What else do we need that they operated with, lived with? One missing piece, and it was one they had to find and put in place. One missing piece is the openness that those early Christians developed toward the world that surrounded them, to those who were outside the kingdom at the time. They had to have a change of heart and a change of strategy before they could engage their world as fully as they needed to. They had to learn to neither fear the world outside the church nor to condemn the world outside the church, but rather to reach out to it in the name of Jesus. It wasn't an easy lesson for them, and it's not an easy lesson for us. It's much easier to assume that the world out there likes us and wants to hear from us and is influenced by us. It's harder to think about a world that really ignores the fact that we exist. It's been that way for a while. Almost 30, one Sunday morning where I was pastor, we had a guest preacher, and so I wanted to do something that I thought would be an interesting experiment. So I asked 100 people in our congregation to skip church with me, not to wear their church clothes, but to meet me at church, and we would go out in the community while University Baptist Church held its worship hour. And I asked them to go out into the community and not knock on anybody's door, don't wake anybody up, find people out in the yard raking leaves or walking their dog or whatever they were doing. I want you to find 10 people each, and I want you to ask them 3 questions. And so I gave them those sheets and then to write down the answers they got. Well, the first couple of questions had to do with things going on in the community, but the third question was simply this: can you name 3 churches in our community? Now, this is a no-brainer, and these people are technically rocket scientists that live there, okay? All right, 3 churches in Clear Lake. I mean, anybody could go, well, Clear Lake Methodist, Clear Lake Baptist, Clear Lake Presbyterian, right? But these were people who weren't in church on Sunday morning. And I went out. Actually, we ended up with 30. I wanted 100 people to do it, but we had 30. So we talked to 300 people that day. And this was consistent with all 10 that I talked to, and it was also consistent with what my friends did. When it came to that question, can you name 3 churches? People would stop and ponder, and they would go, oh, well, there's one over on Space Center. I think that's a Presbyterian church, but I don't know the name. And there's another one, and sometimes they could come up with 3. Occasionally, they could come up with a name. For the most part, they were just puzzled. One person goes, aren't you the pastor of that? He had been to our Christmas church. Sorry. Now, if I had asked, could you name 3 donut shops in town? If I had asked, can you name 3 dry cleaners? If I had said, can you name 3 grocery stores? They could have popped those out like that. It's not like there weren't any churches. There were 30 churches out there. They were everywhere. They were invisible. They might as well have been Buddhist temples as far as the culture was concerned. And that was 30 years ago. I just want to tell you that there's got to be some other way to engage this world than hoping they're going to think we're important or hoping that they're going to think we've figured it out. And the first century church is the one that we turn to. Part of it is asking God to work this deep change of heart in us toward the people of our world, these people that don't know us, may not trust us, may even despise us, but certainly ignore us. Being resolved to bear witness to our world calls for a change of heart on the part of the church, and we have to consider some serious moves. One of those is we need a change of mind, a real clear change of mind about who it is that God loves. Simon Peter and the believers at Jerusalem had to go through that. Peter's confidence was that he knew for sure God loved the Jewish people, and he had been faithful to the Jewish people for a long time, and Peter was a Jew, and now the Jewish Messiah had come, and God was about to bring his Jewish Messiah's kingdom to bear, and Peter was right in the middle of that, and he knew that to be true. But Gentiles, that's another question. And so this disturbing dream he has of this unclean being let down, and God saying, arise, Peter, kill and eat. And Peter going, no, Lord, no, I've never, I've never approached anything, touched anything, eaten anything unclean. And God's word, what I declare to be clean, you have no business judging as unclean. Peter got the message that Gentiles apparently were people God loves too. And it's a message that needs to seep into my heart and yours, ours, as we bear witness to this world. We need to know that God loves all people and not just the clean ones, not by our definition. We need to know that racial barriers and economic barriers and gender barriers and religious barriers and political barriers and lifestyle barriers and appearance and age and all these things our world uses to divide people up into clean and unclean do not apply to the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel is for all people. Who is it out there that God does not passionately love? Who is it out there for whom God did not sacrificially give his son? Who is it out there that does not bear God's image, however marred it might be? The gospel's universal appeal has to sink deep into the heart of God's people, a change of mind. Truthfully, it's a good question to ask as you read Acts chapter 10, is who really was converted that day? Was it Cornelius and his household? Well, yes. But it was also Peter. And shortly after that, as Peter bears testimony to this event in chapter 11, it is the church that gets converted. The church learns God has a love that is broader and wider and deeper than they had really imagined. Always a good question to ask among God's people. Who is really welcome among us? Where is there really the apostolic openness on the part of God's people? And that apostolic openness requires not only a change of mind, but it requires some kind of change of plans as well about who it is that is going to be reached. Peter had no strategic plan that says, you know, I think I'm going to go down to Caesarea and see if I can reach out to Gentiles. He had no intention of doing that. God broke through and took him down there. And then Peter, of all people, I mean, he's a fairly authoritative figure in the first century disciples, wouldn't you say? He goes back to Jerusalem and he gets called on the carpet for this event. What were you thinking going to a Gentile's house preaching the gospel? Let me tell you what happened. He had a dream, an angel appeared to him, he sent for me, I went there, I preached, and before I could finish my sermon, before I had baptized anybody, the Holy Spirit fell on the whole crew, and they were speaking in tongues and worshiping God like we did on the day of Pentecost. It was a Gentile Pentecost, I tell you. And they said, really? Yeah. So it's all, I couldn't refuse water of baptism to these that God had obviously accepted, so I baptized them. And they all calmed down. They said, well, apparently, God is accepting Gentiles. That wasn't a strategic move on Peter's part. It was an obedient move. But after that, it became a strategic move on the part of the church. There were believers that went from Jerusalem up to Antioch, and they began bearing witness to Gentiles. And before long, Barnabas was up there leading that operation, and he sent for Saul of Tarsus to come over, and they worked with this church for about a year. And out of the church at Antioch, God's Spirit called Paul and Barnabas to be these strategic missionaries who would go out into the world and preach the gospel to the Gentiles and establish churches out there. It was a change of plans. They began to shift their thinking and asking, what does it mean for us to follow a God who loves all of the world? And how do we take this gospel out there? Peter had no intentions of getting outside his comfort zone. He wouldn't have thought it up on his own. He was steeped in a tradition that would have completely forbade it. He was comfortable in his environment where everyone thought and spoke and believed pretty much like him. It wasn't a real challenge, at least theologically, to share the gospel with Jews. They were like him. They deserved to hear. And to Peter's credit, if there were any Jews around who hadn't heard the gospel, they had a pretty good chance of hearing it from Peter. The Gentiles were another story. Now, the application of that truth is rather painful to me. Your presence and mine in this community does not change their hopeless situation before God. Not automatically. The reason is, we're comfortable. We can be entangled in a web of comfort like Peter. We can be caught in the icy grip of inertia like Peter. We can be addicted to our traditions and our ways of doing things like Peter. We can be hypnotized by our habits like Peter. We can be constantly recognizing the boundaries of what is comfortable and what is not. Now, to our credit, if our children will attend church with us, they have a pretty good chance of hearing the gospel and coming to faith in Christ. And if our neighbors are evangelical of one brand or another, they have a pretty good chance of being invited by one of us to something we're doing at church. But if they are unsaved and secular and unchurched and depending on us to reach out to them, they may be in some trouble. If we do not intend to reach them, that is, plan to do so, then we will not. The Great Commission was not something Jesus gave to the world and said, "All authority is given to me in heaven and earth. Now, all of you people get to church and hear the gospel." They have no command from God to attend church. We have a command to go into the world and minister in Jesus' name and share the gospel. There's a nursery rhyme I learned when I was growing up. Little Bo Peep, you know Little Bo Peep? Little Bo Peep lost her sheep, couldn't tell where to find them. What was her philosophy? Leave them alone, they'll come home, wagging their tails behind them. Well, that's one way to do church. And then there's the Good Shepherd way. Jesus said there was a shepherd who had 100 sheep. 99 of them were safe in the fold, but there was one that was lost. And he left the 99 safe in the fold and went out to find that one lost sheep and bring it back. And when he did, there was great rejoicing. There's a difference between being a Little Bo Peep church and a Good Shepherd church, isn't there? One takes initiative. One just sits back and waits. The 1950s and 60s, it was probably okay to be a Little Bo Peep church. We had a different role to play in culture, and we had a different kind of respect in the culture. And people who were having questions or issues in their life might very well find their way to church. Leave them alone, they'll come home. It's not going to work in the 21st century. Churches need to be Good Shepherd churches. Christians need to be Good Shepherd Christians. We are either planning to do that or we're planning not to. We're either planning to obey Christ or we're planning not to. Apostolic openness means not only a change of mind about who God loves, but it means a change of plans about how we will live our lives and how we will do our ministry. And it requires a change of practice about what it is we're going to do. In Acts chapter 15, this question is still on the table for the earliest church. They're still wrestling with this thing of reaching out to people different than them. And there are some people who were very upset about the changes that were being made and all these churches being planted among Gentiles, and they weren't being asked to keep the Jewish law. And they raised that issue, and the apostles gathered in Jerusalem in Acts 15 to try to settle this once for all. And they listened to testimony, and they listened to the word of Scripture, and they listened to the voice of the Spirit. And finally, James spoke out for them and says, "It seems obvious to me that God has opened his heart, this gospel, to the Gentiles by faith alone, apart from the works of the law." Our practice is going to have to change, not just our plans. One thing to acknowledge the need or the propriety of reaching people other than our own kind, but it's another thing to act. It's one thing to know that we live in a comfort zone. It's another thing to move out of it into a mission field. Practice needs to follow theology. We're always giving off signals in church about who's really welcome among us. We need to be sure that those signals we give off are in line with what we profess to believe. I'm going to tell you the truth. I don't think we have a clue. I include myself. We don't really have a good clue about what to do with these increasingly secular neighbors of ours. One answer the contemporary churches try to do is, well, maybe we could entertain them the way the world entertains them. And so we try to do that with our worship and music and programs and such as that, but addressing their felt needs. Maybe they'll flock in if we'll do that. But that's a little Bo Peep thinking. It's trying to attract people to something they're not even thinking about. It's not the answer. It may help in some places, but it's not the answer. There may be some things that need to change among how we do things, but it's not the answer. It's too easy. It's too much of a quick fix attempt. The hard part is doing this loving relationship with people because they deserve to be loved, not to try to trick or attract into our organization. Well, actually loving our neighbors as ourselves, that's the hard part. Being their friends, not in order to convert them, because they need friends and we need friends. loving them as friends, introducing them to our other friends who are also believers, and letting God do his work there. That's part of what it is. Conducting our ABFs in such a way that if I were to bring my secular friend, they would find a welcome there. We want to be that kind of community. Praying that this would be the case. Praying God would send us to these places. Inviting neighbors to join us in service, not just in services. In mission work where that's appropriate. Not fearing them, not condemning them, but loving them. Listening, serving, praying, waiting until the opportunity is there, like Cornelius, when he says to Peter, "Tell me about Jesus." And Peter said, "Let me tell you about Jesus." Being resolved to bear witness doesn't mean we have to preach to everyone we see. It does mean that you and I need to develop an apostolic openness, a willingness to be sent by God wherever he might send us, to whomever he might send us. It means an openness to developing friendships with people who aren't exactly like us, loving them, serving them, praying for them, inviting them to join us with our friends at SLBC for an event or to worship or just to have fun. It means intentionally moving out of our comfort zones and into the lives of people that God already loves as we encounter them in our community, at school, soccer, baseball practice, our community circles. These are people that we know at work. They're people that live down the street from us. There are people sometimes in our families. We know them from the gym. And it eventually means that we are ready to bear witness to them when the Holy Spirit invites us to speak. And we do so without shame and without fear, trusting the Holy Spirit to work in their lives. What would you be willing to be resolved to do this morning? To pray for a greater openness to God's leadership and bearing witness in his world? To crossing some comfort zone barrier that's been standing there staring at you for a while and begin to love a neighbor who's outside faith in Christ. Ask God to send you to someone that you could demonstrate the love in Christ, of Christ to and begin to pray for. What would you resolve to do? We begin a new year of ministry together to bear witness to our world. Let's pray together. Our Father, if this were easy, we know we would already be hard about the task, and many in this room are. But many of us really do need the encouragement of your Spirit and the confidence in your work in the world to begin to pray to make ourselves available to you in a fresh way to reach a world that you love so much and that doesn't know you at all. And we pray that you would help us with that, Lord. We do not strike out on our own. We ask you to fill us with your Spirit as you filled your first century church. We ask us to empower and embolden us to do what we need to do and to fill us with the kind of love for people that would be evident to them. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.